ahead and get started. It's, we're getting started a little bit late. Call this meeting to order of the Livability Committee. And, first item on the agenda today will be, Mr. Jim Campbell. We're going to be discussing some, ideas regarding our county park system and, much anticipated presentation. Jim, Jim?
Well, I hope it's worth the buildup. What we're here to do today is to try to seek some council guidance on the county park system. The county has some decisions to make in the future with regard to the park system. And we're trying to follow a logical, deliberate process in arriving at those decisions or arriving at some recommendations. And the first thing I want to do is to, at the risk of, offending an old boss who told me one time, you never educate elected officials, you just inform them. But I think it's probable that, some of you may not realize all of the parks facilities that we operate or maintain or own. And it's really interesting, to me right away, how few park facilities that the county actually owns. And indeed, of these facilities, how few of them are actually active. Like, for example, if you look at number 4 over here, that would be Cherokee Springs Park, which was purchased years ago and hasn't been developed yet. If you look up here at number 7, that's Holston Creek Park, which y'all recently voted the money on. And then there are places that are very hard to find unless you know they're there. Like this right on the North Carolina line up here is something called Little Africa Park. And I defy you to ever find it, except for Mr. Mintz, perhaps, since it's in his district. He knows where it is. But some of these parks aren't very well marked, and so they're not very obvious when you drive by.
Jim, what are the little red dots?
All the little red dots are schools.
Okay.
And this makes a point that I've noticed about Spartanburg, and this is a contrast to what I'm used to in Greenville. It seems like in Greenville, community life tends to be organized around the cities, because the cities have park systems, etc. In Spartanburg, it seems like community life is organized around the schools, because every school represents an area that's served, and that's kind of feeds into something I'm going to talk about later on today.
You know why that is? Textiles. And at one time, Spartanburg had, right at, I think it was 88 school districts. It was all because these, all the textile companies.
And, you know, that also talks about the community structure as well, that you'll notice that there are old textile towns around here that have park facilities in them that, like, just as an example in the case of Packlet here, one of those facilities is actually owned by a local company and is leased to the town of Packlet and operated by Spartanburg County Parks Department. Not the cleanest of relationships, but nonetheless, it seemed to work over the years. And then here's a really interesting thing that I think people don't generally know about is what I call the joint use facilities. And for the most part, these are schools. And for the most part of those schools, this is where our after-class education, after-school recreation, if you will, operates. Notable exceptions are like USC Upstate right here, where we have some shared use soccer fields, and like over here, where we have a shared use tennis facility with District 5. But one of the things that I think is obvious here, and we've already been reaching out to some of the superintendents, is there's a lot of potential to have a greater degree of cooperation between schools and parks. As some parks are a natural partner with schools and vice versa. And in a lot of communities, you see good relationships with those two entities. And I think here we've got the basis to build on some things for the future. So, before we get into the recommendations, do y'all have any questions about the structure of the system? Okay.
Jim, is this the point where we need to, I need a motion to go into executive session and discuss contractual matters related to the status of the county park system and receive legal advice.
Is that moved?
Okay, motion?
Second.
All those in favor? Post? Okay, then go into executive session. I guess we need, staff can remain?
Yes, I've asked Mr. Luton and Mr. Mullis to stay with us. Justin, raise your hand, Justin, is of course our parks maintenance guy. And John Luton, everybody knows, he's Mr. Tiger River Park. And I've got them here mainly so that they can answer any questions y'all might have, because they have a longer institutional memory than do I.
I did.
Let's see. Y'all want to go ahead?
Okay, the Livability Committee back into session. We have exited executive session and are now resuming open committee discussions. Jim, if you'll go on.
Okay, yes, I'll attempt to summarize what we are talking about. Basically, have been delivering some information to the council about the kind of issues that we've got to face in trying to deal with some of our parks and the improvement of them. And what we have done is we have engaged a consultant to start looking at some of these things. The project isn't finished yet, and this is just sort of a interim discussion. For example, I'll just go through some of these parks that we're looking at right now, starting with Cleveland Park. We're looking at an essential investment there in the near term of about $290,000 for the purpose of improving the playground primarily. Berry Field across from Cleveland Park, we have some problems with the old bleachers there that we need to fix, and also it strikes us that that's an opportunity to improve the parks in that area since it's surrounded by a neighborhood on three sides. The Old Painted Road Soccer Complex is an extremely popular venue for soccer. We have some issues there with deferred maintenance that needs to be fixed, some paving and other such things. And, yes?
Can I stop you for just
sure.
A second? If you don't mind, if you could just go through and name the park and just basically give your recommendation. We recommend it,
okay.
That the committee keep this park or increase maintenance or something like that. We don't really need to know,
okay,
you know, any of the details.
Okay. Again, Old Canyon Road, what we're talking about there is addressing some deferred maintenance and accessibility issues, and we estimated it cost about $594,000 for the essential improvements down the road, the desirable improvements, including lighting the facility, might be upwards of $1.4 million. The 295 Sports Complex, again, our recommendation would be to improve the access to the playground equipment, to improve the accessibility again, and to meet applicable codes, and to deal with deferred maintenance issues. Around $445,000 for that, and that facility is about 30 years old. Vadamar McMillan Park, our recommendation there is that we begin to build out and finish that park, and the first investments would be 3 to 5 multi-purpose fields to address the need for more public soccer fields in that empty area up in the corner. Linville Hills Park is a park that's in a neighborhood, a low to moderate income neighborhood, and we think it has great potential for a family-friendly neighborhood park with a relatively minor investment of around $127,000. Arkwright Park is a very small park that's very near the Hope 6 project, and to enhance development of that neighborhood, we would like to explore expanding that park and making it a better community of asset than it is right now. Cherokee Springs Park is a parcel that was purchased for a regional park. Given the many needs that we have in Spartanburg Parks, development of this park is probably a decade out. In the meantime, we would encourage the council to consider giving this over for the use of the Department of Natural Resources for hunting and fishing. Glen Park is the starred park up on the left side. That's an unbuildable parcel that came into the county's possession years ago. And we don't intend to do anything with it right now, but we see it as a good potential linkage for a trail system linking to Cleveland Park in the future. Little Lafferty Park, that's a park that's up near the North Carolina line. The maintenance of it is an issue for us, and we will be recommending to the council that we actually try to find someone to donate that park to who's in the area, such as one or more of the churches that are there. This is a no investment, but just to tell y'all about this, Hillbrook Park and Eastway Park are both parks that were developed privately and are owned privately. And our role in it is that there's a coaches pitch baseball league that operates in both of those parks. We provide the maintenance of the fields and they pay us for that. Just an unusual situation, but quite a good one for us. The Woodruff Leisure Center is a center that we operate. It's the star up in the corner. There is some discussion going on right now and some grant activity going on to develop trails in the Woodruff area that would encompass a portion of that parcel that's below the star facility. This is the Inman Sports Complex. It's owned by School District 1. We see the need for some investments there, and we have actually talked to the superintendent that if the county were to supply some investment, they might take over the long-term maintenance of this. This is the T.W. Edwards Center. This is something that we'll recommend to council that we work with the city of Packwood on, because the building was built some 40 years ago, and we think it would be a good idea to start looking at alternatives to replace it. This is the McKinney Park in downtown Woodruff. We are looking at the possibility of linking that to the maintenance of the Woodruff Leisure Center and partnering with the city on the improvement there as well. Calpins Park, same story. They are part of the Parks and Recreation Special Tax District, as are Woodruff and some other cities. We would look at partnering with the city to do those essential improvements to address safety issues and some drainage issues, particularly that make the playground less than it could be. Greater Packlet Park also has some issues that need to be dealt with, not the least of which is cleaning up the ownership a bit. It is currently owned by a private company, leased to the city of Packlet and maintained by Spartanburg County. So cleaning up that relationship is going to be key, as is making some essential investments. Fairmont Larkin Park is in a relationship with the Fairmont Larkin Parks Commission. And Parks Commission is a legal entity created by the state legislature and is no longer in existence. The county owns the park where this leg that comes out to the road is, and a private individual owns the balance of the park. This park does have some difficulties, needs substantial investment, but because of the unclear relationships, we don't recommend that the county continue to maintain this park. Southside Park is owned by the State Department of Parks, Recreation, and Tourism. It's actually part of Croft State Park, and we are on a year-to-year lease with that facility. We no longer program the facility because other facilities are available. The Westside Booster Club has expressed interest in using the park, and our recommendation is that we use our good offices to let them do that and to encourage Parks, Recreation, and Tourism Department to contract with them instead. Now let's talk about some opportunities. We've talked about what we focus our trail efforts on, and this is an example of how we might want to think about trails in the future. This is a perimeter walking trail around North Spartanburg Park, and you see legs of that trail going across vacant property and also a sidewalk going up to the entrance to a subdivision for the purpose of encouraging recreation by the people who live there and also safe access to the park by kids. We will continue to look at blueways. One of the things we want to do is enter into formal relationships with agencies such as the Tiger River Foundation and the Palmetto Conservation Foundation, because they are better suited, quite frankly, at obtaining the easements and other rights of way than we would be as a governmental agency.
This is where I think we missed the boat, talking about waterways and blueways. I mean, for years, we watched our waterways and talked about them, just like the Tiger River. The Tiger River Foundation has been out there off of Highway 50. They've got their barricades. People can't get in there. I mean, if we could give some leadership or some help or some money or whatever we have to do to move this thing along, and the Tacklet River, again, we've got these great assets that we just haven't been able to, to take advantage of and make them happen. And we're running out of time. I mean, we only have so much time here for all of us. Whatever we need to do, and maybe we're going to have to be the catalyst to make this happen.
Well, one of the things that we've done with both the Tiger River Foundation and the Palmetto Conservation Foundation is one of the folks in the office, Eric Davis, is working actively with both of them. But they are able to do things in terms of contacting property owners that are less difficult than if we would try to acquire the property. And so if we can provide the staff support to them, because they're volunteer organizations, then maybe we can, like you say, get things done.
I mean, I would love to have a report at one of our committee meetings, our livability committee meeting, to find out what's going on with the waterways, the blueways, what do we need to do? If we have to get the Tiger River Foundation people in here and these others, because if they're better at getting right away, I just haven't seen in the last 3 years anything happen. There's been a lot of talk, but I haven't seen any action. And every time I ride by that, whatever it is, the park on Highway 50, and they've got it barricaded up. They open it up once a year for the Tame the Tiger. I think we're just missing a lot of opportunities, and people going up to the Green River. And let's step it up.
I agree with you 100%. This is an interesting opportunity. We have done very little for the west side of town, particularly like Lyman. And this is an opportunity where they are actually creating a park, and they've asked county council, or in a meeting with Mr. Culbert, to assist them in closing the loop on the building of this park.
Jim, let me go back to what I was saying about that stuff. I mean, before you got to these slides here, you showed that park in Packlet is privately owned, and we contract with the town of Packlet to do work on it, and we got other properties, and I mean, it doesn't seem like it's a real smooth, seamless deal. That's what I think we need to be working on, and challenge you and the staff, come up with a plan, a major plan, get us out of the things we don't need to be in, and that really serve, the people of Spartanburg that are bogging us down from doing the good that we know we can do, and let's do that. Let's take the money and the energy. Just like the one you were just showing, if it's not providing a real service to the people of Spartanburg, let's get out of that stuff and let's get on with what really does make it sensible and let's make it work.
There's no doubt that the county can be a good catalyst in getting things done, and this is a great example of this. This is an opportunity, I think, up in the Chesney area where we have a privately owned park, a nonprofit owned senior center, and the possibility of bringing those two things together in a vital improvement for the Chesney community. And quite frankly, the only person that's going to, our only entity that's going to be able to bring that off is somebody like Spartanburg County. Another opportunity, as I said, we've reached out to the schools to talk about partnerships. This is one that came up right away from School District 6. This is the old alternative school that's out in Dan Corner, right here. This building was recently demolished. It's about 25 acres in total. It's well located, and to me, it looks like a great place for four or five soccer fields, which is a need in our community.
It's 2 miles or less from, that's profiles from Westgate Mall.
Right. This is a really fun idea that we've talked about with the staff at SJWD. I call it the Lake Cooley Paddling Center. They already have a park, and this is a dam. And they've got some bad playground equipment. They've got some picnic shelters. And we were talking about the possibility of building a building that would house their staff here, and we would help staff it as well. And what it would do is store canoes and kayaks that one of our staff could teach people in this clean, pure, easy to navigate water how to use a kayak on those rivers that we have in abundance.
See, that's forward thinking there.
The last thing is, there are many organizations like SPACE, for example, that are great organizations, but they don't have any staff capacities to speak of, and they also lack resources. I think we're in a position to work with them and sort of leverage what they can do and what the county can do. And this is just one example here of this bridge, because right now they have a bridge that's built out of old Duke power poles that's deteriorating. And we think that this is a role that the county could play into engineering and providing something like this to help out their efforts.
Hold it right there.
Okay.
I went out and met with the Glendale Outdoor Leadership School Goals a couple weeks ago. In fact, we were supposed to have our committee meeting, and I talked to you about this, Roger, next Monday, the day of the council meeting. They've invited us to come out, and I went in around this meeting. I thought it would be good just to make sure everybody understands what it's all about, because they wanted you, Jim, and Catherine, and whoever else, all the council members, to come out there where we can partner. You know, in the past, there was not this teamwork going on with the goals group. They've got incredible things going on out, you know, in that area, on the Packlet River, on Lawson's Fork, doing their leadership school, where and they have opportunities. When I met out there, we had the guy from Columbia, he's kind of their statewide director of these programs, and there's federal funding, you know, to help make this happen. I mean, they've got money. All they need is a little bit of help from us in leadership, and sometimes just a little bit of money to make, you know, all these bridges take place, the rope courses up in the sky. I mean, our own citizens can go out there and use all that stuff. So Monday at 12, if y'all can do it, they said they would like to host us out there, and the media's invited as well. Come talk about partnering with them.
And another thing about partnering that we've talked about, and I think this is sort of vital, and it gets back to the whole information thing. There are so many things out there in Spartanburg County people just plain don't know about.
Yeah.
And if we can find a way to sell that comprehensively, the community will be better off. This is another interesting idea. This is Burns High School, and this is a piece of land that's owned by the town of Lyman. And look at this as a future potential soccer complex that maybe would benefit District 5. It would certainly benefit Lyman. Maybe this is a future large soccer complex that could be attractive to youth team sports. And finally, I'll finish up on a really neat idea. This is an old, the Clifton 2 textile mill that's now being torn down. And we have an opportunity at some point, once we just council decides, to buy this property and turn it into what I, as a placeholder, have called Packlet Shoals Park. We currently have the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service engaged in doing a sediment study to make sure that we have no issues out there with chemicals running downstream. But once we finish our due diligence process, we will be coming back to council with a recommendation on this. assuming that we find no issues out there.
What's the timeframe on this?
We will have the results back in June, I understand. The last one is, this is a piece of property that's actually in Welford that the county owns. A contract was done for this to lease it to Welford some years ago, and then it was never actually, nothing ever happened. And I'm just putting this up here as an opportunity to show you that this is the sort of thing that maybe we could work with Welford on to incentivize them, much like folks in Lyman did, to create something there that would be good for the Spartanburg County citizens. And that's all I have. I'd be happy to try to answer any questions.
Anybody have any questions?
Hey, who else can be here Monday?
I got you.
And if you wanted to meet here and ride out there together, I'm glad to do that. Unless you just want to meet there. It's in downtown Glendale.
What time is it?
12 o'clock.
Meet at the mayor's office.
Pardon?
At the mayor's office.
No, at the Goals facility, right behind the church. Jim, can you make it?
I believe.
Where do you want to meet?
I'm writing down now.
If you want to meet here, we can all go out there together, or we can just meet there. Yeah, it might be easier.
And I'll bring out Eric and Jenna too with us. Jenna is, I like to call her Superwoman. She's the one who teaches how to run a kayak. And Eric is the one who's been working with the volunteer groups and trying to come up with some of these great ideas.
And you can, I don't know if you've been out there.
I have.
It's really interesting to see what they do. They're bringing people from outside of Spartanburg in, spending money here, you know, to take these courses and do this, you know, a lot of good things in the community. So, we do a little partnering, I think we do a lot of good.
Anybody, anything else?
I just wanted to take a moment to thank the committee for your guidance and for giving us the opportunity to talk with you about some of the components of the Parks Enhancement Plan. We'll take the feedback and some of the challenges that you've given to us back to our consultant and to the team. And as soon as we have a more formal work product to bring to Livability Committee, if it's okay with you, I'll work with you on scheduling that presentation.
Anybody else? Jim, thank you so much for the presentation. Very thorough. I know you've worked on it for a long time, and this is exactly, I think, when we started looking at this whole park situation a year or so ago, this is exactly what we envisioned, that we would really take a good hard look at where we were, where we needed to go, and clean house on some of the things that we didn't even be involved in, and I think we're on the right trail here, no pun intended, and I hope we can move on. So I hope we've given you some guidance, and we look forward to your report.
We certainly have. I'll say thank you as well on behalf of the park staff for all the support that y'all have shown to us in the past months as we tried to work through our many issues. And I can say one thing, we've got a good team over there, and the guys that sit here, they're doing their best.
They deserve a lot of credit. They've done a great job. I appreciate it, John. Everybody else keeps it with them. But we appreciate it, Jim. Anything else from the committee?
Just a reminder to any members, council members, the 5:30 is the citizen.
Okay. Got it. Need a motion to adjourn?
So moved.